three pages.
Yep. Probably.
So do you have brothers and sisters? You have one brother? Dad, you remind me, you, I'm like, I feel like, so looking at you, I feel like I know you, but I know I don't. But I have a friend that I used to work with that had stars, it's like preschool. Like her a lot. Like a lot, but I think God only made so many molds, I think this is difficult to move on.
Ching, I'm back here. Hello?
Hello?
Dad? Want me to get you anything? Want a drink or anything? Want me to grab it for you?
No, I mean, you'll go out and hungry.
I got a set this and then I.
Go to the state park, it's on the right hand side, that's out there in that park. Yeah, it's beautiful, it really is, black people, people have their senior pictures and stuff, I know that they got it.
I agree with that. I went for it last night.
Did you?
I heard about this thing.
Is that for Frank Loud?
It's called Prairie Chicken, actually, if you go on the little app right here.
I love that song.
Inside of the building is a big page. A people that have been here in this town.
That's the lunch.
They are very good.
Oh my gosh, look at this. I'll be back.
You must be playing Little Drummer Boy?
Yeah.
I've been reading from the scripture.
Okay, we got this going. Yeah.
I have a rig of technology so I can zoom in as well as in class. My pants are also awesome. Everybody's getting quarantined, everybody's dating. It's crazy.
I know, it's nuts.
Yep.
Everybody call rumble pump pump. Thanks, gentlemen. That was awesome. Welcome. Welcome to The Awakening. My name is Kevin Drain. I'll be your pastor this morning. And whether you're catching us here live in the Fellowship Center or you are going to watch a broadcast on our website or Facebook or Comcast 13, we're delighted to have the opportunity to worship with you today. I have some announcements, if you don't mind. Let us jump into those. The hospitality team needs single-serve cookies and canisters of hot chocolate mix. A week from yesterday, or this coming Saturday, December 18th, is when we have our Journey to Bethlehem event. We sure are praying that we have our Journey to Bethlehem event. But we do need refreshments. If we do the event, and when we do the event, I guess, maybe I should be saying, we need snacks. So single-serve cookies and hot cocoa mix would be appreciated. If you feel like you are called to donate, just bring the items here, leave them in the kitchen area, and you might mark them JTB, Journey to Bethlehem. Okay? Ladies Bible Study, Tuesday morning, 9:30 in Price Lounge. Children's Sunday School will meet in the youth room today and also on Sunday, December 19th, because we have all this stuff set up in the gym for the Journey to Bethlehem event. The Journey Advent study obviously will continue during Sunday school hour between our services. The one for Thursday is going to be canceled this week, so it will be canceled. Kewaunee Ministerial Association will hold the service of the longest night next Sunday, December 19th at 6 p.m. at the Zion Lutheran Church. So the service of the longest night next Sunday, 6 p.m. Zion Lutheran. It'll also be aired on their Facebook page and on Comcast 13. Let's see. I guess the M&Ms and the tree did not pertain to the awakening. Youth group will resume today. Sorry. Youth group will resume today, 4 p.m. for junior high, 6 p.m. for high school. Reboot will have a scheduled team meeting for the 21st, December 21st, 6 p.m. at Price Lounge. If you would like to donate a poinsettia in honor of someone or a memorial that we'll utilize during our Christmas services, then call the office and let them know. And you need to bring the poinsettia by the 15th so that we have it here. Again, the Journey to Bethlehem, Saturday, December 18th, from 10 a.m. until noon. If you are so inclined, we can use plenty of help. It's one of our outreaches, one of three major outreaches that we as a church utilize. And with that in mind, please be praying about the Journey to Bethlehem. Our plans right now are that we will continue and hold the Journey to Bethlehem. But you also know that COVID is seeing a tick up and it's going through a lot of the schools, which is exactly the target audience that we have for the Journey to Bethlehem. So we'll probably make a decision, yes, or maybe to just do a video or an electronic Journey to Bethlehem. And my guess is we'll make that call by Tuesday, Wednesday at the latest, and perhaps as early as Monday or Tuesday. So please be in prayer about that. We want to do the best thing for God, but we also want to do the right thing for our community as well. So sometimes that's not always really, really clear. Journey to Bethlehem meeting will be held this Tuesday, 6 p.m. in Price Lounge. All the cast members need to be present. Dress rehearsal Thursday evening and Friday evening at 6 p.m. meeting in the gym. We will do those even if we don't have the Journey to Bethlehem open to the public, because we will want to practice so that we can video at the very least and broadcast the Journey to Bethlehem. So again, be in prayer for that. We're in need of firewood. We want to be able to build a couple displays upstairs for the Journey to Bethlehem. Have extra firewood. feel free to bring it by and donate. 12 Days of Christmas Stories begin airing tomorrow, Monday, and the time will be 6 p.m. on Channel 13 due to the Kewaunee City Council, and they meet at 7. All the other stories, though, that we will go through will be at 7 p.m., and they'll be posted on Facebook and YouTube pages as well. If you need to record a story, contact the office so that we can get those scheduled. She's not here, but I can make the announcement. Some of us worked ringing bells for Salvation Army, and this morning at first service, Ann Young wanted to thank everyone who rang bells, and I know the Salvation Army was delighted, at least for what we were doing at Farm King. And I have to be honest with you, as I was ringing bells Friday afternoon at 1 o'clock, I was delighted that we were at Farm King because we're inside. And as it was pouring outside, did I say I was delighted that we were at Farm King? Yeah, I was. But what a good opportunity to do some mission work for our community. Any other announcements? Excellent. Then I'm going to call on our Advent readers to come up, and we'll switch places.
Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Philippians 4, 4 and 5.
Today we light the third candle, the candle of joy.
From Isaiah 12, 2-6. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. The Lord himself is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. With joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. And that day you will say, give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done, and proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known to all the world. Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of Zion, for he is great. For his great is the Holy One of Israel among you.
From Luke chapter 3, verses 7 through 18. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. What should we do then? The crowd asked. John answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Don't collect any more than you are required to, he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them.
Praise is acknowledging and celebrating the nature of God. Worship is our response to God through our actions and witness. Joy comes when we live out our faith in tangible ways.
Let us pray. O God, may we praise and worship you, not only in words, but also in deeds. Amen.
If you would, join me as we sing, O Come, Emmanuel. O come, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God. Thank you. Thanks for the Advent moment. And, you know, typically we're pretty laid back during the awakening. We ask a question. Has anyone had a God moment that they would like to share with the group? Any God moments this week?
Yep.
Coming your way.
This is kind of a funny, maybe a little humorous God moment, I guess. So, you know, a lot of times we talk about God like smacking us in the head or whatever, but sometimes God will nip you in the butt. So I was talking to Donna the other day, and it's been a busy week around here, and so I've been running around 100 miles an hour, and I'm in the middle of a conversation with Donna, and all of a sudden my phone in my back pocket turns on, and it's real loud, and I'm like, what the heck? And I pull it out. There's a big old snapping turtle. There's a live video of this giant snapping turtle on there. And I don't know, I just get the first thing I looked at her and I'm like, what is this? And she's like, well, maybe that's God telling you to slow down like a turtle. And I kept thinking, it was kind of funny. I thought, wow, that's maybe so. I'm kind of a God moment, maybe telling me to slow down, you know? Maybe brought a snapping turtle out on me.
I'm next.
I have another grandchild moment. We went and rang the bell, Nolan and I, yesterday at Farm King. And I'm telling you, he had a bell in each hand. And when anybody come through the door, he'd go, Merry Christmas, God bless you. Aww. And I think it was like 100% of the people donated.
Oh,
it was hard to turn the little guy down, you know.
That is true.
Got a little antsy at the end, but we managed.
Excellent. Anyone else? God moments.
I have a praise. My niece Isabella and her brother Marcus have been coming on Wednesdays to our youth group, and they've really display the characteristics that God wants to see in us. They live it. They're so young, but I look at them as just an example of how we should be. They're so kind and humble and just amazing.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
See, I got great grandkids.
Anyone else? A God moment?
The whole season's sort of filled with God moments for me. My life sort of is avoiding Christmas until my teaching ends, you know. But they keep creeping in. The Salvation Army ringing was great. The Christmas music is great. The Journey for Bethlehem. So they're all God moments because they drag me out of my my other world, you know. Get me a little more focused.
Anyone else? God moments? Praises or concerns?
Want to keep Dave Chamberlain and Martha in our prayers She's doing a lot better, so our prayers are working. So it's not a good time to stop now.
Dave and Martha Chamberlain.
Yes.
My sister Kim and her husband have the COVID, so she just found out this morning. So luckily, amen, that I have been around her, so we're good. But she definitely needs some prayers.
Anyone else? Praises or concerns?
For a friend that has a cancer scan this week and for good results.
We've got one from our Facebook. Pray for Ken Van Wassenhove. He's in Geneseo Hospital with some issues that are not related to COVID, but just pray for him that all the issues are cleared. I'd also like to continue to pray that I was in down at OSF all week this last week, and just pray that they were able to find the answers to the questions that they were wanting. This was all planned, that I go in and see if they could figure out what's been causing the seizures that I've had in the past. So I pray that they were able to answer some of those questions, and I will go to my doctor here in just a couple weeks to see them.
Praises, concerns?
The tornado victims. It's our
Allen. Tornado
victims. Tornado
victims. Oh, yeah.
Kentucky, right?
Yeah, Missouri and Illinois.
Anybody else?
Thanks, Allen. Let's pray. Our Lord and our God, we're humbled first and foremost, Lord, that you are mindful of us as human beings. Lord, we do appreciate all those moments where you make yourself known to us, and we know you're always with us. Sometimes we're not so diligent that we're looking, and so God, when we have those breakthrough moments, it's just amazing. And so thank you, God, for being mindful of us as human beings. And thank you for being willing to hear our prayers 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. You are ready for us to pray. Thank you, God. You've heard us as we have shared those God moments. You've heard us as we've given you praise. Lord, we do. We give you praise for healing that you've already done in so many people's lives. And Lord, yet we have family, friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, neighbors, acquaintances, who are in need of your healing touch. And so we lift those folks up to you, Lord. Your word says you know every hair on our head, and I think that means that you know us better than we know ourselves. And so, Lord, we pray for those who are struggling physically, those who are perhaps battling disease, those who are concerned, those who have had operations, those who are having tests, Lord, we just pray that through the power of your Holy Spirit, you are ministering to them physically. And Lord, sometimes our brokenness isn't physical, sometimes it's emotional. And so we do. We lift up all those who are grieving. We lift up those who are in quarantine and perhaps anxious and their families and friends. And Lord, we pray for our community. We pray for those who struggle with addictions. So, Lord, we know you to be a healing God. We know that you can heal physically. We know that you can heal us emotionally. And lastly, Lord, we pray for spiritual healing as well. Thank you, God, for the way you refresh us, the way you replenish us, the way you take care of us physically, emotionally, and yes, spiritually. And so we just lift all these folks up to you. We pray for you to be our healing God. Thank you, God, for also being a forgiving God. We come before you confessing that we probably haven't loved you the way we should. and we probably have struggled to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And so, Lord, we come before you confessing and seeking your forgiveness. And then, Holy Spirit, help us to not just be forgiven, but to also be forgiving ourselves. Help us to be more Christ-like in our actions and in attitude. Thank you, Jesus, for coming. Emmanuel, God with us. Oh, come, Emmanuel. Again, we look forward to the coming of your kingdom. We pray all this now in Jesus' holy and righteous name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
I think Carrie is going to read scripture for us. Carrie, would you do that?
Reading today comes from Luke 1:39-45. Mary visits Elizabeth. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Carrie. Well, as you are aware, we have been reading a book for the Advent season called The Journey. And this is the third week. It was written by a pastor in the Kansas City area named Adam Hamilton. And so, 2 weeks ago, we learned all about Nazareth and Mary as we read the beginning of our Advent study. Last week was all about Joseph in Bethlehem, wasn't it? And today we'll learn more about Mary's visit to Elizabeth. Anyone struggle? I have to admit, I'm just a struggling Christian. You know, Paul said in Romans, the 7th chapter, verses 15 through 17, "I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do." In other words, the stuff I know I should do, I struggle to do, and the stuff I know I shouldn't do, I seem to do. Don't we all struggle that way? This whole humanness thing, we struggle with our sin nature, don't we? Every day, it seems like. But thankfully, we have a God, we have a Savior, we have Jesus and the Holy Spirit that have these immense levels of forgiveness, immense levels of mercy and love, and unending, never-ending levels of grace. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that a praise the Lord? That's a hallelujah moment. Anyone here ever need help? Yeah. Help me, Lord. Well, here's a true story. A motorcade carrying the Gaza Security Service chief came under fire from Israeli troops during an Israeli-Arab conflict in April of 2001. The frightened security official called Yasser Arafat from his car for help. Arafat, in turn, called the U.S. ambassador to the Palestine, who then called the U.S. Secretary of State, a gentleman named Colin Powell. Colin Powell then phoned a gentleman named Ariel Sharon. He was the prime minister of Israel, who incidentally ordered the shooting to stop. And it did. So the security chief had reached out for help, and his connections eventually saved his life during a firefight that he was in the middle of. Similarly, think about this. Christians have a connection to God. God's help makes a world of difference in any situation. Amen?
Amen.
I said God's help makes a world of difference in any situation. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, it sure does. Well, today Mary finds herself a willing participant in God's plan, but it still has lots of challenges, doesn't it? She needs help. She needs support. I guess we could say that within the COVID situation that we've gone through these last years, it seems like, a lot of individuals and a lot of companies have needed help. Some literally need help, don't they? I mean, if you've been to a restaurant lately, I'm not sure I've been to a restaurant that wasn't asking or had up help wanted signs. It's crazy, isn't it? It is an odd place to be. So some literally need help, and some certainly figuratively need help as well. For Christians, help is good. But here's a true statement. Help is good, but God's help is the best.
Amen.
God's help is the best. Amen. Yeah. Psalm 6, 11 and 12. Say this. Give us help against the adversary. Who's our adversary?
Satan
is our adversary. Sure, we have battles in this physical world, but we also have spiritual battles going on all around us all the time. Amen? I mean, think about it. God is a God of love and unity, and Satan is about creating division and chaos. And wow, there is a battle between good and evil. So, give us help against the adversary, for the help of humankind is futile. Verse 12, through God we will do valiantly, and it is He who will tread down our enemies. Certainly, God will take care of Satan for us. Well, 2 weeks ago we began our journey as the angel Gabriel revealed to Mary that she was pregnant. And during that conversation, he also alluded to the fact that Mary's cousin Elizabeth, who was thought to be barren, who had fertility issues, was in her sixth month of pregnancy. Well, here's today's scriptures. Luke 1, beginning in verse 39. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea. So think about this. You know, 2 weeks ago, we were talking about Nazareth. We were talking about Mary. The angel Gabriel was there. He told her that even though she was just kind of in an engagement part of her wedding contract, so to speak, with Joseph, that she was going to conceive. The child would be of the Holy Spirit. And that brought on lots of challenges for her, didn't it? And yet, by the end of the conversation, she's turning to the angel Gabriel and saying, as you have said, so may it be, right? I'm willing. I'll do what God wants me to do. And now we suddenly see that in verse 1, it says, at that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea. Now, the trip from Nazareth to the town where Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth lived, the town of Ein Kerem, was probably a 9 or 10 day journey. It was approximately 60 to 100 miles to travel. Ein Kerem was very close to Jerusalem, as we saw last week, about a two-hour walk from Joseph's home in Bethlehem. Scripture says she left hurriedly. Now, why did Mary want to see Elizabeth so anxiously? Did Mary post on Facebook that she was going to visit her cousin? No. Did she tweet about it? Did she tweet, you know, hashtag Cousin Elizabeth, or hashtag Vacation Ein Kerem, or hashtag Mute Zechariah? No. No phones. No internet. No email. We don't even know for sure that the cousins had ever met. I mean, you say, well, they only lived 9 or 10 days apart, and yet, back then, people didn't get around like we do. You know, today, we jump in a car, and we don't think anything about having a date and running to Chicago and back in an evening or a day, for sure. Or we can hop on Amtrak right here. We have all those options. Back then, it was kind of a big deal. And honestly, it hasn't been many generations since that would have been a big deal here, too. You know, there were a lot of people who would get married in Kewaunee, I suspect, and their honeymoon destination was the Quad Cities or Peoria or Chicago. And yet today, we don't think anything about going to Bermuda for a destination wedding or the Virgin Islands or anyhow. People were not nearly as mobile back then as we are today. Mary didn't call an Uber. She didn't hop on a bus or a train. Verse 40. Where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. So did Elizabeth and Zechariah both meet her at the door? They say, well, what's the big deal? Well, think about this. Zechariah was assigned to the temple in Jerusalem. And he was part of a Levite clan, if you will, that he was a priest. And yet, we know that while he was there and contacted by the angel Gabriel, because he didn't have faith, Gabriel came and said, you know, your wife who you think can't conceive, she's going to conceive and give you a son. And Zechariah was kind of like, yeah, right, whatever. And the angel Gabriel struck him so that he was deaf and mute and would stay that way until when? Until the child was born, absolutely. Until John, who would become John the Baptist, right, was born, Dad Zechariah couldn't speak, couldn't hear. Now, I suspect he had a leave of absence from the temple, don't you? So there's a real good chance that when Mary got there, Zechariah and Elizabeth greeted her. Verse 41, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Wow. Now think about this. Mary comes walking up or into her home, and as she walks in, Mary greets them. You know, I don't know, bless this house and bless its inhabitants. May the Lord bless you all. I don't know what she said, but she greets them. She says hello. Probably thanks them for the opportunity to enjoy their hospitality. I suspect that all of that was very, very dramatic. Verses 40 and 41 tell us, she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth, and according to our commentary today by a gentleman named R.K. Hughes, his commentary called Luke, that you may know the truth, he states this, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb. There was a strong human joy in the meeting of these two expectant mothers, one in the flower of her youth and the other's bloom fading quickly. Through their birthing pain, sweat, and blood, and their mothering too, the world would receive its greatest blessing. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah, you bet. The world would receive its greatest blessing. This is incontrovertible testimony to the pre-birth personhood of John the Baptist. I mean, think about this. He was a prophet even before he was born. Isn't that amazing? I mean, he hasn't been born yet. There's three more months before Elizabeth will deliver John, before Zechariah will begin to speak and hear again. And yet, John in the womb is already being prophetic. That's amazing. Verse 42, in a loud voice she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." Again, from our commentary, as John vaulted in his mother's womb, Elizabeth underwent an elevation of soul, an inner expansion of her human spirit, as the prophetic spirit seized her. She then saluted Mary as the mother of the Lord. In a loud voice, that's how the scripture says it, in a loud voice. It could have been translated in a great cry or with a shout. She exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." I suspect the Holy Spirit got a hold of her and she could not contain herself. Amen? Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Elizabeth affirmed Mary's wonderful secret as she gave her a double blessing. She blessed Mary's coming maternity. Mary was blessed among women, and the just conceived son in her womb was also blessed. See, Mary probably needed an affirmation about what she had agreed to do. Amen? I mean, the angel Gabriel said, "This is of God." And she said, "Yes, I'm willing." That was her greatest trait, wasn't it? She was willing to subject herself to what God wanted in her life. Mary was willing. But that didn't mean it was over. It didn't mean she and Joseph wouldn't be the talk of the town, right? Well, she needed to be affirmed. Verse 43. "But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" That's a huge, huge statement. "Why am I so favored," Elizabeth asked, "that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" What a natural question. Mary had just heard from Elizabeth how she is blessed from God and her child would be my Lord, Messiah. Trust me, every Jew was looking for Messiah. They all wanted to come back into power politically. They weren't expecting a Messiah to come and deliver them from their sin. They were expecting a Messiah to come and deliver them politically from their oppressors. But here's Elizabeth saying her child was Messiah. So the question then is, how did Elizabeth know? How did she know? They haven't spoken. They just said, "Hey, how you doing? I'm here." And boom, the Holy Spirit kicks in. Mary hadn't told her yet. Remember? She didn't put it on Facebook. She didn't tweet it out. She didn't give her a call. She didn't write her a letter. Chances are she would have got there before the letter did if she had, right? I mean, how did Elizabeth know? It was spontaneous via the Holy Spirit. Mary must have been ecstatic at Elizabeth's knowledge without being told the situation. I mean, can you imagine? Can you imagine how Mary felt? And all the time, if it took her 9 or 10 days to walk down there, she had nothing to do but praise God and think about all the repercussions that were going to come from this situation. And yet she gets here and Elizabeth somehow knows. And says, "You're blessed, and guess what? He's my Lord in your womb. Here was one who, without any explanation, immediately understood her secret and celebrated it by pronouncing this double blessing, affirming Mary and her child as Messiah. Mary had to feel like God had given her a gift, an affirming gift in Elizabeth. Verse 44. As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Elizabeth explained what happened in her response. Right? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. You see, the situation here is that before Elizabeth herself could return the greeting, the child in her womb leapt. John the Baptist in the womb responded before Elizabeth did. That's cool stuff. That's just awesome God moment stuff. Amen? Only a mother can relate to the sensation described here, because more than a prenatal kick or a turn had occurred, it was a leap, an upward vault. The word translated leaped here is typically used to describe skipping or leaping lambs or sheep in the pasture. I don't know, you guys watch sheep or lambs bouncing around? That looks pretty joy-filled, doesn't it? I mean, it just kind of makes you smile. Why did Elizabeth's baby react this way? Well, the answer can be found in two words. The first word is prophet, because John was a prophet. And the second word is joy. Joy. He was a prophet in the womb. And his first prophecy was about Jesus. Even before John the Baptist was born, he prophesied. His prophetic ministry actually began 3 months before he was born. It just blows my mind to think about. John 3:29 sums up the joy part, I think. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine and is now complete. See, that's what happened. John the Baptist didn't hear Jesus' voice, but he heard the voice the woman who would deliver, carry him and deliver him. John the Baptist in the womb was full of joy. Verse 45. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her. This is kind of a big verse. I want to read it again. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her. Okay? So Elizabeth concluded her outburst from the Holy Spirit with a formal beatitude, if you will, in verse 45. To grasp what's going on here, we need to think back. We need to understand that Zechariah, who was deaf and mute because he had not believed the angel Gabriel about Elizabeth delivering a son. Right? Now, see, earlier I said, I'll bet you that Zechariah, I guess preachers shouldn't bet you, but I suspect that Zechariah and Elizabeth are standing there interacting with Mary. Right? I think that's going on. He had to be surely amazed. The question I have is, yeah, he can't, He can't speak and he's not hearing. But is it possible that the Holy Spirit was letting him know what was going on? Were tears streaming down his face? And do you catch the irony that he's in the condition he's in because he didn't believe the angel Gabriel said, your wife's going to have a child. And now his wife is saying, blessed are you, Mary, for you believe. That's pretty good stuff. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished. The Holy Spirit celebrated Mary's faith as she believed and submitted to God's will and so became the mother of God's Son. Let's think about Mary's faith for just a second. You know, to grasp it, we have to understand that faith is more than just an intellectual belief, right? Faith is more than just an intellectual belief. Faith is belief plus trust. Faith is about believing and trust. Understand this, we can discern a pattern in Mary's celebrated faith. First, Mary intellectually believed what Gabriel said. She believed that the virgin birth was possible and would happen. Mary did not doubt. Second, she trusted her whole life to God's promise. And third, this trust brought about submission. Mary submitted to God. Remember her words? May it be to me as you have said. That's what she said to the angel Gabriel. May it be to me as you have said. And fourth, out of that submission came this energized activity. She immediately obeyed God's word. She hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea. Here's her conversation with the angel Gabriel. She gets done. She says, I believe it. I trust God. I'm going to submit and do what he wants. And then she takes action because the Holy Spirit must have been goading her, pushing her, guiding her toward her cousin Elizabeth. Why? Well, we'll get there. So four things that Mary did well. She believed, she trusted, she would submit, and she would act or take action. That was kind of the pattern of her faith. That's a nice pattern for any of us to follow, wouldn't you say? Believe, trust, submit, take action. Well, like Mary, we also need to hurry. Hurry? What do you mean? We need to hurry to be at church. Because there we find people like Zechariah and like Elizabeth who share a mutual faith, believing the same things. Isn't that important? Mary's faith, as great as it was, would it have faltered had she not had some affirmation from her cousin Elizabeth? Isn't that possible? I don't know. What Mary needed, the help she needed, was affirmation from her cousin. Affirmation that things were going to be okay. Sure, God told her that. Don't we all believe and yet still struggle? Do you think Mary would be any different? Therefore, we need to purposely place ourselves within the fellowship of those who also believe God's word. Christians will naturally experience a mutual growth in faith as we share what we believe in with one another at church. Isn't that what it's all about? Here we come together, we talk about what we believe, and then we lift each other up. We edify one another. Some days you're up and you're down, and we help one another. And the next time we get together, maybe you're down and you're up. That's what church is about. It's about us. Helping just like God helps. We're called to help one another. Be Christ-like. Amen? Yeah. Well, okay. So we got to take this home. What have we learned today? What are the take-homes for this message? Well, first, that Mary believed and then trusted and then submitted and then acted based on her faith. And all this is best when it's inspired by the Holy Spirit. Because nothing, that's a pretty absolute word, wouldn't you say? Nothing. Does that mean there's anything outside that? Nope. It says it with the word. Nothing is impossible with God. Nothing. Nothing is impossible with God. Nothing. Dr. Carl Bates of Amarillo, Texas, stated during a statewide Baptist conference on evangelism, here's the comment he made. If God called his Holy Spirit out of the world, about 95% of what we're doing in ministry would continue, and we would brag about it. What a blunt statement. What was he trying to say? Well, the answer comes in his next question. What are you doing that you can't get done unless the power of God falls on your ministry? So what he's saying is, to put it another way, what are you doing that requires help from the Holy Spirit to be successful? He was saying we need the Holy Spirit's guidance in what we undertake. God's power will allow us to accomplish anything. Jesus said it. Is he a liar? No. With God, nothing is impossible. So, what's the problem? Our limited power and our human insight keeps us from setting our sights on large, godly goals. Amen? We think too small. The analogy I used this morning was that it's kind of like me going to the outside of my house saying, well, we need some water, and I turn the spigot and here it comes, out the end of the hose. But when we are Christians, I don't have a tower like we have here in Kewaunee. Our power comes from something as massive as God. That's the difference of me turning on the spigot at my house and the Niagara Falls, right? And yet in our humanness, we struggle to believe what we can accomplish. We need to set lofty, godly goals. What else have we learned today? Well, we learned that Mary needed encouragement from her cousin, Cousin Elizabeth. And Elizabeth probably needed encouragement too. I mean, let's face it. She's in her 6 month of pregnancy. She'll have challenges herself. Who provided Mary with the support that she needed? Now we could say, oh, well, Elizabeth did. Yeah, that's kind of true. But isn't it amazing to look at how all this is interwoven together by God? God was there when Gabriel brought Zechariah to his knees, right? Because he didn't have the faith that his wife was going to deliver him a son. Think about that. God was there. God was there when Gabriel came and explained to Mary what was going to go on. God was there when Joseph heard the story from Gabriel and said, you know what? This child conceived is of the Holy Spirit. God has all these intricacies woven together because God has a plan. Amen?
Amen.
God had a plan, he has a plan, and he will have a plan. For you and for me. God has your back. You as an individual and all of us as a church. God helped Mary and Elizabeth. God will also help you. Do you believe that? God will also help you. Psalm 121 verse 2 says, my help is from Yahweh, maker of heaven and earth. Here's a good example about divine help. Matthew 9, beginning in verse 21. And this bit of scripture is about a man whose son seemed to be demonically possessed, right? And he had brought his son to Jesus' disciples and asked them to pray and heal him, and for whatever reason, they couldn't get it done. And so now he's talking to Jesus. And so he, Jesus, asked his father how long it was since this had been happening to him, the boy. And he said, from childhood. And often it has thrown him both into fire and into water in order that it could destroy him. But if you are able to do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Verse 23, but Jesus said to him, if you are able, all things are possible for the one who believes. And Jesus is not a liar. Verse 24, immediately the father of the child cried out and said, I believe. Help my unbelief. Isn't that the way it is for us? Don't we say, I believe, and yet we struggle at times? I believe, Lord, but help my unbelief. Because we have those days when we're rock star Christians, and we have those days where not so much. I believe, but help my unbelief. Couldn't that be each and every one of us? Couldn't that be our prayer? Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Wow. Two things I want you to take home. Two things. One, God has a plan, and our loving God wants to help you. Second thing, where is God providing you an opportunity to help others, to help the church, to help the kingdom? You need to leave here understanding God has a plan and He wants to help you. And secondly, that He's going to provide you opportunities to be a help yourself. You need to look around and see where God is giving you helpful opportunities. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
So maybe you can join us in a nice Christmas carol.
So in the last couple of weeks, we've learned a lot about the journey, right? And we each are on our own journey. And as we exit this place today, believers who are called to edify, to uplift one another, let us leave here, right? Taking the love of Christ with us. In the name of God the Father, Jesus Christ, His holy and perfect Son, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, let us leave this place, taking the light, taking the love of Christ with us as we go. Go in peace. Go in love. Amen.